Starting and so come.
Right, I think we can start because we've got a quorum already. Right, please invite the administration in. We have the permanent secretary with us. We'll be discussing the refined proposal on the design of private health insurance policies regulated under the HPS, as well as public funding support for the implementation of the HPS. Right. Permanent Secretary, are you ready? Yes. As usual, we heard from the media that there that some revisions were proposed, and then we were given papers from the administration. So, the Permanent Secretary, please, Chairman. The fact was that we issued the paper and then the media put questions to us. Chairman, at an earlier meeting, we briefed members on the proposal on the design of private health insurance policies regulated under the HPS. And concerning hospital, individual-based hospital indemnity products, we are now proposing the minimum requirement in order that policy holders can really make use of the insurance that they've taken out. We require insurers to at least meet the so-called minimum requirements. And in fact, there are 12 items under minimum requirements, and they can be divided into three categories. Category 1 seeks to improve access to and continuity of health insurance. And items under this category include guaranteed renewal, no lifetime benefit limit, coverage of pre-existing conditions, and then guaranteed acceptance and premium loading cap. And then the second category seeks to enhance quality of insurance protection, including coverage of hospitalization and ambulatory procedures, coverage of advanced diagnostic imaging tests and cancer treatments, and minimum benefit limits, so that policyholders know with greater certainty out-of-pocket expenses. And then category C, promoting transparency and certainty. And also, we do allow employees the conversion option in the first year. And for policymakers who do not want to choose the conversion option, so long as the insurer agrees to continue to manage these existing policies, the policies can be retained by the existing policyholders. And with regard to group-based indemnity hospital insurance products, because of the uniqueness of the group-based market, we do not want to make group-based products subject to the minimum requirement, but we understand that some employees may want to be covered after retirement. And so we require insurers to, when offering group-based products, provide an extra option, extra component of a conversion option to employers, so that employees, when they leave their employment, can switch to an individual standard plan at standard premium without re-underwriting. So the advantage is that re-underwriting is not required, and there will be sustained and affordable insurance protection upon retirement or leaving employment. So this is the content of the first paper. So do we want to have a discussion first, or should I go on to introduce the second paper to members? Let's have a discussion first. All right. 2 minutes for members' questions. Please do not comments or all right. Do we want an internal discussion? Now, Mr. Chen, I want to say that the insurance sector is the major stakeholder. What do you mean by 2 minutes? Oh, now when I previously when I gave members 3 to 4 minutes, members used all the 3 minutes or 4 minutes, giving their views, and no time was left for officials to give replies. And so in this subcommittee, the arrangement is that 2 minutes will be given to a member for him to ask questions. In other words, the time taken up by the official in his reply will not be counted towards the members' allocated time. Now, because I have my own views, and I also need to reflect the views of the insurance industry, and so 2 minutes is simply not enough. So maybe we can have multiple rounds of questions, Chairman, if I can only get 2 minutes every time. If you want to give your comments, then perhaps I can stop the timer, and then you can continue to speak. I think I'll need about 10 minutes. Mr. Vincent Fang. Now, of course, Mr. Chan comes from the insurance industry. He is familiar with the industry, so perhaps we can let him speak, and then we can ask questions. Because we have time, and he is familiar with the operation of the insurance industry. All right? I think I will give you sufficient time to air your views at an appropriate juncture. I think it's important that your views are recorded in the minutes of the meeting. Also, perhaps I can let other members ask their questions first. And then if you want to give your comments, and I'll stop the timer, and then you can take a time to give your comments. All right, so let's have questions from members first. KK Kwok. And then check in, Paul. KK Kwok, 2 minutes. 2 minutes for your questions. 2 minutes for your questions and comments. The time taken up by the Permanent Secretary will not be counted towards the time allocated to you. Yes, Chairman, we've received the updated papers. You want to encourage members of the public to take out insurance, and you are encouraging the adoption of the minimum requirements. But then concerning MRI, CT, policyholders have to pay 30% of the cost. Of the public are of the view that the public sector can't meet their demand in respect of services like MRI and CT. You are saying that there may be abuses. I want to know why you've got the impression that members of the public are abusing the MRI and CT services in the public sector. Yes, Permanent Secretary. Now, MRI and CT not covered in most policies. And the insurance sector is of the view that if these are covered, then patients may request MRI or CT service, even though that may not really be required. That is what we mean by a moral hazard. So if these are covered, then maybe patients will request the doctors to refer them to MRI or CT service. And that's why we are of the view that the policymaker should also shoulder part of the cost in order to combat the moral hazard. 30% is our preliminary proposal. In the consultation document, we will lay down the 30% and we'll see whether the public support this percentage or not. Now, I think it's really outrageous that insurance companies are accusing people of abusing such services. Now, with regard to high definition screening or checks, now the trend is that more and more people have to undergo these checks. In fact, 2D x-rays may delay the commencement of treatment. So did you consult the patients? Did you consult the doctors? It seems that you merely consulted the insurance companies. And secondly, do you have actual figures to convince us that people may abuse these services? Permanent Secretary, Chairman, at the moment, many policies do not cover MRI or CT. And if these are to be covered, then the premium will have to go up because the premium will have to reflect all these factors. That's why we are proposing co-insurance. We are proposing that the patient be asked to pay part of the cost. And the premium will not have to go up by such a large extent. In fact, we've made reference to overseas examples, Chairman. Maybe after the meeting, we can give the information to Mr. KK Kwok with regard to overseas experience. We are of the view that with coinsurance, the premium levels can be maintained at a more acceptable level.
Secondly, Chairman, only those who have to pay 300% premium can go into the high-risk pool. Take a patient at 50 years old. How much money does he have to pay before he will be included in the high-risk pool? P.S. Chairman, initially, we are still calculating the figures. In the end, we have to wait for the completion of the consulting report before we can have accurate figures. Take someone at 20, 30 years of age. The premium would be around $3,600. If you are 40, 50 years old, it would be around $4,000 to $5,000. And if you multiply it by 3, it would be $15,000. Chairman, I don't know how many people in Hong Kong can afford $15,000 in terms of insurance for health protection. I think that is impractical. Mr. Chen Kinpo, Chairman, first of all, let me talk about the views of the insurance industry and then my own views. If you think I will be speaking for too long, please stop me and I will be happy to wait again. Actually, the Hong Kong Federation of Insurers sent a submission to the F&H Bureau on the 4th of December on their views, and also on the 6th of December, the Hong Kong FI sent out a press release to say that the HPS will be doubtful in terms of its effectiveness. I'd like to take you through the gist of that submission. It is said that the individual insurance and group insurance are providing protection for 3 million people in Hong Kong, and actually without government intervention, every year there are 180,000 new policies to show that members of the public do think that health protection is useful. In terms of surgeries, etc., 90% of the people received the service in private clinics and hospitals. In other words, those who have health insurance have gone to private hospitals instead of some people saying that they have the insurance but then they still patronize public hospitals. I think those are the minority. Also, in terms of in-service policies, every $100 pay, $75 for that will be paid by the insurer. For ambulatory small surgeries, $90 pay out of every $100 would be paid by the insurance. In other words, the coverage does not protect total protection. And what is most important is that in the private market, there are different products. Some are more expensive than others to cater to the different needs. The biggest change ushered in by this policy is that you are going to regulate health insurance. In other words, you can only go for the more expensive products. Sorry, Mr. Chen. Not too many members are queuing up. Let them answer the questions first. No, I like to cover all the views before they give a reply, or else if I stop halfway, they will not be able to answer me. I think, Chairman, it doesn't matter if I carry on. As you know, there are not too many members who are likely to ask questions. I don't understand why you are so keen on keeping time. Okay, there are no members queuing up. You just continue. I think you are not going to bring added benefits to the public. You are actually depriving consumers of their right to a choice. The Hong Kong IF doubts how many people will join the HPS. If the number is small, how can you achieve the purpose of taking people out of the public system and let them join the private system? Now I'd like to go back to my own views. Starting from 2005, I started to take part in the task force or working group of the FH Bureau. I actually started before Mr. Yok Chow. The entire team had been replaced, but then I have always been here. I understand Mr. Piers and your colleague, Mr. Chris Sun, have spent a lot of time on the design of the proposal, and I think the implementation will not be easy. But then if you're going to launch it as it is designed now, then, you know, actually you wanted to target the fees charged by private hospitals and also the operation of health insurance. You like to convert it so that the public will get better health services which are more transparent and more affordable. But then you are not going to provide what you promised. This will be a loss for all the parties concerned. As you know, most of the premium paid would be paid towards private clinics and hospitals. Now, you do not force private hospitals to provide DRG. And so the premium will probably not go down as a result. So how can you depress the enhancement in premium? There will be regulated health insurance products, and people can only sell those products which meet the minimum requirement. The consultant has already said that the new product would be around 10% more expensive than the existing insurance, but then that figure has not been confirmed by the insurance industry. There is an estimation that compared to the cheaper products now, there has to be an increase of 30 to 40% in premium before there will be the meeting of minimum requirements. So you are depriving people a choice, and the public have to shoulder at least an increase in 10% of premium. And now they cannot look at their own affordability to buy a product of their choice. In the future, either they do not take out the insurance, or they will have to go for a product at a certain level, and you have to pay a certain premium before you can do it. I think this brings chaos to the market, and this is against the principle of a free market. Can you request private hospitals to show you all the costing? Of course, you cannot. In terms of incentive, the FH Bureau is talking about tax deduction, but you are not mentioning the tax incentive, which is very useful. For example, 30% incentive at first buying of the insurance, and then when you retire, there will be a 30% subsidy, etc. So there will be an incentive for people to take out the insurance on a continued basis. But now you see less incentive, and then because of the lack of transparency at hospitals, there will not be the DRG, and the premium will not go down as a result. And with the lessening in incentive, there will not be more transparency, there will not be any reduction in expenses. Then what are you going to do with this HPS? You are just stifling the operation of the private market. So I think both the insurance industry and the public are going to lose out. And you also have to set up a new regulatory body to regulate an ineffective system. It will just be a bureaucratic body, and you are going to waste social resources. And basically, my stance is that everybody is going to lose. I am talking about the overall responses. And if you go into the details, I will have other questions to ask. But then I think the insurance industry, the public, and also everybody else is going to lose. P.S., did you take down all the questions? Chairman, thank you. I don't have to actually write down the points, because what the member has said is basically what has been covered in the submission from the Hong Kong Industry Federation of Insurers sent to us last week. Do you think I need to reply to those now? First of all, Mr. Chan would like you to give a written reply, but you haven't done so, is that right? I think what the member is saying, that the Hong Kong FI has written to us, we will certainly reply in detail. And they also issued a press release. And Mr. Chan, the member, has given us the gist. If necessary, I can give a brief response here on the main points. Okay, go on. First of all, it is said that in the past few years, there have been a surge in the people taking out private health insurance. That is a fact. But on the other hand, we are aware that if there is a quick surge, we have to make sure that those who take out the policies would have to really understand what they have taken out to prevent future problems. For example, do you think, do they know that the coverage is sufficient? Or do they know whether there will be a guaranteed renewal, or is it that at a certain point there will not be renewal anymore? They may not know this clearly. If there is a surge in the number, and also if there are problems in the future, there may be a big problem from the angle of consumer protection. So we think we need to act early in order to enhance the awareness of consumers, and if necessary, we have to step up regulation to make sure that this growing market can really protect the insured. Secondly, the figures of the Hong Kong IF is wrong. It is said that 90% of the insured receive treatment at private hospitals. We have conducted a market survey. We asked people who have taken out private health insurance and those who have been hospitalized in recent times. Only 50% of them used the policies. In other words, there is another half who have taken out the insurance, have not gone to a private hospital, but they still went to the public system. We said many times in previous discussions, because the coverage may not be enough for hospitalization or for particular surgery, and they are worried that after I make a claim, the premium will be increased in the next year and there may not be renewal. So if it is not very expensive, they rather take pay out of their own pocket, or they will go to a public hospital and leave the private insurance only for eventualities. Because now in the policies, there is no guaranteed renewal clause. If you take out the insurance, you make a claim and you don't know what happens next year. In many public consultations, this is the biggest concern of the insured. It is said that at present, it is said that the most of the premium is spent on private hospitals, but actually there is a public figure that in the private individual insurance market, the claims level is at 57%. In other words, in terms of health insurance indemnity, only 57% is paid out for that, and the rest is used for administrative matters. That is 43%. And of course, we are all concerned about fees charged by private hospitals. If we ask private hospitals to provide more transparency or so-called to monitor their fees, I don't think we can do the same for insurance companies. And this will amount to regulating the market. So we have not gone down this route. We have gone from the angle of overall protection for consumers. And we say there should be minimum requirements so that there will be basic protection. And everybody who takes out insurance will understand what they have taken out. If we provide for the minimum requirement and you say we limit the choice for consumers, well, actually, now the biggest choice rests with the insurers, because basically now they can choose the insured. They can choose whether to sell a policy and also choose how long a policy should be for. So now there is asymmetry in terms of choice. The choice now is bigger for the insurers instead of the insured. Now, if there is the minimum requirement, then the premium may go up by 10%. We are still discussing with the insurance industry. If they have figures, we would be happy to continue the discussion with them. The thing is, if there will be 10% increase in premium, there will be so many more benefits, including you can undertake MRI, CT scan, etc. Such procedures will be included. Ambulatory surgeries will be included. In other words, there will be a lot more protection. You have to balance the increased premium with the increased protection. Now, some people may be paying lesser premium, maybe by 10%, 20%, but then the protection may be a lot less. Is that reasonable? We are discussing with the industry. We'd like to have information or data from them and to decide whether this is reasonable for consumers. Maybe I stop here, Chairman. Well, we really don't know who is right, who is wrong. I myself have also many questions, and there are other members queuing up as well. I will write down all the questions and I will tackle them one by one. Ms. Mac May Kun.
Yes, Chairman. I think we want to take some pressure off the public healthcare sector. That's the most important objective. Mr. Chen Kin Po represents the insurance sector. Of course, he has expressed some professional views, but I think there are a few good features proposed, including coverage of covering ambulatory services and also pre-existing conditions. Now, I believe people who have wanted to take out insurance but were not able to will be attracted to take up insurance. Oh, sometimes for a company, if an employee works for a company and then leaves employment, he's no longer covered. And then, when he retires, it's difficult for him to take out insurance in the private sector. But then it seems that you haven't said too much about the conversion option in the paper. Will you be giving us more details later? I think we need more information about the conversion option so that people will be covered after their retirement. Apart from the covering ambulatory services and pre-existing conditions, what more can be offered? Or for those who have taken out insurance, or those who have yet to take out insurance, how can you try to attract them to use private sector services so as to take some pressure off the public sector? Permanent Secretary. At previous meetings, members said that a conversion option would be preferred. At the moment, many employees are covered by group insurance. But then when they retire, maybe because they're already 60 years old, or maybe they have pre-existing conditions, it will be very difficult for them to take out healthcare insurance, or it would be expensive for them to do so. And so after discussion with the insurance industry, we've come up with this proposal, and that is for the group-based insurance. Insurance companies will offer two options to the employer: group-based insurance and an extra component, and that is the conversion option. So long as the employee has been employed for a full year, immediately before transferring to the individual standard plan, and no re-underwriting will be required. As you know, the employers are quite sensitive about the cost of providing group-based insurance, and so we will not make it compulsory for employers to take up the conversion option. But we do understand that, in fact, there are already similar products in the market. And the extra premium is only a few percent. We will, in the public consultation exercise, put forward the conversion option. I will see what the public's response is. Then second question, fees and charges of private hospitals. How are you going to encourage the policyholders to use private sector services? Now, Chairman, this is a voluntary insurance system. Not all the policyholders will use private hospital service. So we need to look at why some existing policyholders still choose public sector service, although they've taken out insurance. There are two major problems of private insurance or private insurance products. First of all, inadequate coverage. For example, operation may cost 60,000 to 70,000, but then the policyholder can only claim about 10,000. And also, insurance products in Hong Kong are different from those in other places in that there is no guaranteed renewal. So if a policyholder is ill and has got compensation, then maybe next year there will not be any renewal, or even if there is a renewal, the premium will go up very substantially. And so many policyholders may choose to use the public sector service because it's only $100 per day, and they will leave the insurance coverage to a later date. So for the existing policymakers, only half of them use private hospital service. The remaining half still go to public hospitals if they have an illness. So to answer Ms. Mack's question, we hope that in future, the HPS will be able to offer adequate coverage to policymakers, and also the policyholders, can be assured that there will be guaranteed renewal, and that the premium will not go up too much in the subsequent years. And that will help to take pressure off the public sector, and will also make policyholders feel that they have got value for money. Mr. Albert Ho, sorry I was a bit late, and maybe I haven't really heard all the replies. I understand that the government's policy is to give Hong Kong people an additional choice, and concerning the high risk pool, there will be some form of subsidy or subvention from the government. And I don't know what the amount will be. But I'm still not convinced. as to why public money has to be used to provide a subvention or a subsidy to those who want to take out insurance. Yes, it's important that the insurance products are reasonable and that they and that policyholders can get reasonable protection. But then using public funds to subsidize the high-risk pool is not something that many people support. Many people would want the government to further enhance the services in the in the public sector. In fact, there is a lot of room for improvement in the public sector in terms of medical equipment, staff resources, and so on and so forth. I understand that the medical equipment used in private hospitals is at least 2 or 3 years more advanced than the equipment used in public hospitals. For example, look at the Hong Kong Sanatorium and hospital and the equipment there. So is it really appropriate for the government to use public funds to subsidize those who want to take out insurance? Permanent Secretary. Now, some people who are policymakers, but they do not use the private sector service, or they dare not use the private sector service. So it's important that transparency in the private sector be increased. And also, after claims have been made, if people can get guaranteed renewal, then they will have more incentive to take out health insurance in the private sector. And so people who have taken out insurance will have a choice between the private sector and the public sector. And of course, if it's a major illness, then the policymaker may still choose to go back to the public sector. Now, during the public consultation exercise, many respondents said that they had wanted to take out insurance to protect themselves, but then they were not able to do so because of some pre-existing conditions. For example, they had certain illnesses, for example, hypertension, diabetes. And so they wanted the government to help this group of people. In overseas countries, insurance companies are not allowed to reject any subscriber. But if you require insurance companies to take up extra risk, then it would be inevitable that the premium levels will go up, and as a result, healthy young people will not want to take out insurance at an early age, and some people will decide to take out insurance only when they've started to have certain illnesses. And so we can't really make it compulsory for insurance companies to accept all subscribers. But then we, at the same time, we want to make sure that all those who want to take out insurance can do so. And that's why there is this concept of the high-risk pool. So if a subscriber has some pre-existing conditions, there will be some loading. And then if the loading exceeds 200%, then this case can be transferred to an HRP. So the risk will not be transferred to other policyholders, and as a result, the premium levels will not go up. So a high-risk pool is like a reinsurance company. And the premium will all go to the HRP. The insurers will not get any benefit. Then why is it that the government has to use public funds to subsidize the HRP? Now, if we don't do so, this group of people won't be able to take out insurance. And when they fall ill, they will have to go to the public sector. If it's the general ward, then it's $3,000 of subsidy a day, and then ICU maybe over $10,000 a day. But then if people have taken out insurance, then they may have the additional choice of the private sector. And in fact, they have to pay a premium every year. And the premium they pay can be a form of subsidy for their future medical bills. But of course, not many people really do understand the rationale behind the subsidy. We're talking about a few billion dollars over a 25-year period. So we'll give more details in the consultation document, including the rationale, the justifications, and then we'll see whether the public favor the idea. A short response, Chairman. Now, I understand that it's good that patients can have an additional choice. So it depends really on the affordability of the patients. Our Permanent Secretary is saying that if these people go to the private sector, then that would take less some pressure off the public sector. But then if there is this high-risk pool, and if this is to succeed, then I'm sure there will a lot of government subvention will be required. So I want to know the figures. I want to know why.
I want to understand why the public will benefit, because I don't think so. I think only certain people will benefit. But as a public policy, I remain to be convinced, because I think you are being selective in subsidizing certain people. Okay, that's the first round. Actually, many questions have been asked, but even if replies have been given, I think more questions will be asked as a result. I have jotted down some questions, and I can help to explain certain things so as to facilitate communication. And I will go from the last question, the high-risk pool asked by Mr. Albert Ho, why should there be a subsidy? I have already recommended to the administration many times in the past that they should give concrete examples. Let us have figures, for example, so we can understand. Let me try to explain it to you, Mr. Albert Ho. I'm not trying to convince you so you would accept it. I'm just trying to explain the operation. And I would only cite one particular disease in order to give you the example. For example, colon cancer. For every 100,000 people, 40 people will have colon cancer. Supposing somebody has colon cancer and the patient has to pay $100,000 for the treatment, for example. So, I suppose, for example, there is no operating cost and so no profit will be for the insurer. Now, if all the 100,000 people will take out the insurance, each has to pay $40. Do you understand, Mr. Albert Ho? And then who are the high-risk people? Those who may be of a senior age, or they have a family history of colon cancer. And for every 100,000 high-risk people, 80 people will eventually have cancer. Once they have cancer, and because they are of a senior age, their medical costs will go to $200,000. In other words, there will be more people having the disease and the medical costs will also be more. And for these people, they have to pay $160 just to cover that one illness. And in other words, 400% of the general pool. The proposal now from the administration is that this person has to pay $120 because that would be the cap at 300%, and the remaining 40% will be paid by the government. Is that right? Am I right? The other $40 will be paid by the government. Is that right? Well, right now, we are not asking the insurers to be the insurer. In other words, we ourselves will issue the policies. But anyway, they will have to take out insurance, and so you are the operator. Now, that is the meaning. Mr. Ho, do you accept that $40 will be paid by government? Your party can think about this, because what the government is saying, that if they do not pay the $40, the government may actually have to pay the entire amount of $160, or the patient will shoulder all the $160 because no private insurer will want to have this business. So whether or not you accept it is another matter. You can think about it. This is how it works. This is what the high-risk pool is all about. So you need to provide such examples and figures before you can explain matters to members and the operation. Is it that even if you apportion the risk, you still have to pay the subsidy, or is it that the entire public will benefit? Well, I hope such figures and examples will be included in the papers for the next meeting. Mr. Chen Kin Po mentioned the effectiveness of private insurance, and it is very different from what the government said. Just now, Mr. Chen Kin Po said those who have taken out insurance, 90% of them will go to the private sector, but the government's figure is 50%. There is a big gap here. I have said to the administration before that perhaps we can explain why there is such a big gap. Usually, patients will use both public and private services. If they have taken out insurance, it doesn't mean that they can only go to private hospital for services. For example, very often, the insurance for cancer will only cover 80% of the surgical costs, and the entire coverage will be used up. And if they still need chemotherapy, they will go to the public hospital for the treatment. So when the patient takes out the insurance, as Mr. Chen Kin Po said, 90% of the people already used up. They have appropriately made use of the private insurance package, but maybe the premium may be low, so the policy does not cover the follow-up treatment. And maybe in 50% of the cases, people go back to public hospitals for treatment. Don't shake your head. I have read previous papers. You said that 60% of those who are insured, no, 40% of them still use public service. But it doesn't mean that they do not use private service. Possibly they have used private service as well, but they may have used up the coverage. And it could be real that 90% of the insured use private service. It is just that they have used up the benefits, and so they go to public hospitals for follow-up. This is quite commonly seen, isn't it? No, Chairman, we will clarify the figures with the Hong Kong FI. Yes, you need to. Because the way they frame it is quite strange. It says for hospitalization and surgical procedures, 90% of them use private service. In other words, they are talking about 90% of those who are making claims. And in other words, 10% of those who are making claims did not go to private hospitals. If somebody has taken out insurance but they use HA hospitals, then basically no claims will be made. And if that's the case, these people do not fall into the figure. So according to our market survey, out of 10 who have been insured and who have been hospitalized recently, only half make use of the insurance policy. The Hong Kong FI is only looking at those who have made claims, but not those who have been hospitalized but have not lodged a claim. That is why we are using different figures. What we are saying is that out of 10 who are insured and those who have been hospitalized recently, only half have gone to a private hospital. But the Hong Kong FI is talking about those claimants. Okay, we know. Now, if that's the case, I'll ask Mr. Chen Kin Po. If patients have taken our insurance but have not lodged a claim, would you know it? They have gone to the public hospital for many things to be done, and what the PS is saying, they would have taken our insurance, but they know they do not have enough coverage, so they do not lodge a claim, they just go to the public hospital. Do you have those figures? Chairman, I think you are excellent in explaining the matter. You are saying that there are people who definitely do not want to use up the benefits in the private policy. Now, I'd like to confirm something. It is said that if somebody has gone to a public hospital, still they have to pay $100 per day, and they can still make a claim under miscellaneous items. I may be able to ask them for the statistics. Even if they go to a public hospital, they can still claim the $100 per day hospitalization fee. I will ask them to look deeper into the issue. But now it is publicly known that over 90% of the people paying at private hospitals are covered by insurance. This is agreed by all. As I said, 99%, but I won't put it at 99, I would say 90%. This is given to you in writing, and you can confirm it with the Hong Kong FI. I think the public would like to know the real situation. Okay, your figures are really too different. 150%, 190%, I really don't know what the subcommittee should do. The administration should go back and study the matter in depth to see why there is such a big gap. Second round, KK Kwok is not here. Chen Kin Po, do you have a follow-up question? Yes, I do, Chairman. Just now, Ms. Alice Mack talked about the benefits of the scheme, say there will be more protection, there will be ambulatory procedures, MRI, etc. But you have to understand that these benefits have a cost to them. It is not that the commercial sector doesn't want to have the business, but then in the end it will be very costly. I personally do doubt whether there will just be a 10% jump in the premium. First of all, administration, have you asked for the confirmation by insurers? Because later on it is not the consultant who will be providing the policies. We don't even know how the consultant has done its sums. So the conclusion is, if in the end the premium increase will be 30% or 40%, will you just cap it at 10%? Because if you dare to say 10%, how can you provide so many benefits? So are you ready to subsidize them? If indeed the premium will be increased by 40%, are you going to subsidize the 30% difference? If that's the case, I really would commend you for being so committed. Secondly, you say people will take out the insurance, but they don't use it. They go to the public sector. But this is going to be so costly. We believe 10 or 20% of people who are insured now will not be able to afford the premium. They will just go back to the public sector. At least 100,000 to 200,000 people will go back to the public sector. Some of the insured will no longer be able to afford it. So you will have a bigger burden. You are going to lose out in the end. I don't know how you work out your sums. What we can see is that at least 10 to 20%, like 200,000 people, who will not be able to afford it anymore, even if they are insured now, they will just decide to go to public hospitals. So you will not be able to achieve your purpose of moving people to the private sector. P.S. In fact, I explained many times to Mr. Chan that we have been discussing the figures with the insurance industry. The consultant has been in contact with them, so the figures are all there. As to the cost, The insurance industry has never told us that we are wrong. We are still carrying on the discussion. And number three, I can say simply that we talk about the minimum requirement and guaranteed renewal. If you have been paying attention, some insurers are already providing similar products. You can see the advertisements on the MTR trains, and you can see the prices on their website. It is very similar to our figures. That is $3,000 for people at 30 years of age, and it's very similar to what we are talking about as minimum requirement. Just go to their website. Therefore, we are quite reassured that if we have the minimum requirement, I'm sure that the premium would not be very different. And that goes to show that this will be within the affordability of the public. Now, you say the premium is now not costly, and in the end, it will be increased. But I'm talking to the insurance industry, and I'm asking for figures. How much are we talking about? And what benefits are we talking about? Is that reasonable? If the benefit is so meager that people cannot use the insurance policy, then it doesn't make sense, even if the premium is very low. So the main point is, even if the premium is low, there is no guaranteed renewal clause. So when you are healthy, they will take care of you, but whenever you fall sick, you will not get any protection. And that is why the risk pool is not that big. So whether this is something good, we have to discuss it further. Chairman, please, can I follow up? Can I respond to what the PS said? Okay, nobody is in the queue, so you can go ahead. PS, this is so important to the public because everybody wants to know how much more the premium will be if there would be so many benefits. If you are confident about the 10% increase, if you say the industry has not objected, please, let us have a written reply. Let us ask the insurance industry for a reply to your 10% increase. I think that would be more fair because that is a kind of promise to the public. Please write down the idea, the response of the Hong Kong FI towards the 10% increase in premium.
And if you are so confident, then can you provide a guarantee? So you've set aside 50 billion, and if a 10% is exceeded, then there will be a subsidy. Now we all know the advantages, all right? $150,000 for cancer, and then covering pre-existing conditions, ambulatory service, and I want to now. So there are so many added benefits, and I do not believe that you can impose a 10% cap when there are all these added benefits. Now, if the Federation claims that this is feasible, of course that's good. But I think you can give an undertaking in writing, Permanent Secretary. Now, I don't think we can do that, Chairman, because we do not only need to take into account the interests of the insurance industry. In fact, we don't know who's right and who's wrong. You said that you had been talking to the insurance industry, but Mr. Chan Kin Po is saying that was not the case. And you said you mentioned 10%, but Mr. Chan Kin Po did not agree. And Mr. Chan is asking you what's going to happen if, upon actual implementation, it's an extra 30% or extra 40% instead of an extra 10%. Now, I don't know how many federations there are representing the insurance industry. Only one, Chairman. And so, you can you try to seek their endorsement concerning your calculations and your estimate of 10%? In fact, Chairman, our consultants have been communicating with the Federation in their calculations. I want to say that the Federation hasn't put forward any counter proposals concerning our figures. In fact, we've given them all our figures. Now, Chairman, I have been in close liaison with the Federation. They are saying that as in the absence of detailed figures, they can't give an endorsement. So all I want is an endorsement. The Permanent Secretary, do you mind telling us how you came up with the 10%? Can you give us the formula? I believe your consultants do comprise actuaries, and not many people can understand actuarial calculations, but there are some who can. So can you give us the formula, and then the Federation of Insurers can check whether the calculations are correct. Yes, that can be done. All right, so please follow up on this one. All right, I wish to follow up as there are no other questions from members. It seems that you're proposing some further requirements or restrictions concerning the age of the subscribers. So, no age limit in the first year. The high-risk group can subscribe, and then second year, those under 40. In fact, all of us here are over 40 years old, and you are giving them only 1 year to consider whether to join or not. Because we still don't know whether the HPS or how it's going to operate, whether it can operate well. How many people do have existing policies, and you're giving them only 1 year to consider whether to switch to your scheme? And you're going to impose the minimum requirement on all the products. And there are some existing insurance products without the minimum requirements, and those over 40 can still subscribe. But with this added restriction, such products will disappear from the market. Do you understand what I mean? So after the first year, you will not accept those over 40 years old. But then because of the minimum requirements, some existing products will disappear from the market because it's not going to be a free market. Chairman, the age of 40 applies to the proposed HRP. We want to make sure that those with pre-existing conditions can also take out insurance. That's why there is a need for an HRP. But if we don't want people to take out insurance only when they have some illnesses. So during the first year, we accept people with pre-existing conditions. But then from the second year onwards, we accept only those under 40. In other words, we want to encourage people to take out insurance before the age of 40. But of course, if they don't have preconditions, if they don't need to have access to the high-risk pool, then the 40-year-old restriction doesn't really apply. But then what's the definition of the high-risk group? The definition is to be decided by the government and the insurance companies. So in the first year, it doesn't matter what the high-risk group is. So if in the first year, if I am regarded as belonging to the super high-risk group by an insurer, it doesn't matter because I will be accepted by the government. But then if you set an age limit or an age cap, then the definition of the high risk group will be affected. In other words, I may not be able to take out insurance because whether I belong to the high risk group or not, it's not for me to say, it's for you to say. So the choices are with the insurers, not the subscribers. And so with the age restriction, if all of a sudden I am labeled a super high risk subscriber, then I will not be able to take out insurance. At the moment, the insurance companies have to do business, and so they will not indiscriminately label people as super high risk groups. But then if you impose the age restriction, then people in future who want to take out insurance may not be able to do so. And also, you're only allowing us 1 year to make a decision, but that we want to know whether your scheme is a good one. We need to monitor that scheme. And you are worried that if there isn't such a restriction, then people may take out insurance only when they become ill. But then say a print condition, there is this waiting time, and or waiting time arrangement, and you have the threefold premium. And as a result, people will have the incentive to take out insurance because you already have these arrangements in your design. So we can see that the government is trying to limit its commitment. Previously, the government committed 50 billion, and members asked what would happen because the 50 billion might be used up in a decade or two. Because previously, it was said that after the money had been used up, the government might increase its commitment. So it seems that you want to cap your commitment. So why is it that you're requiring those over 40 to take out insurance in the first year? Now, Chairman, I think we need to consider one factor, and that is we need to try to balance the private sector and the public sector, and we also want people to take out insurance when they are young. The premium will be lower and the risk can be better spread. That's why we want to encourage people to take out insurance at an earlier age. And so we just want to encourage people to subscribe at an earlier age. And also, as concerning these pre-existing conditions, usually they appear when a person becomes old. So people would tend to wait until they are 40 or 50 to take out insurance. When they are young and healthy, they will not want to take out insurance and start paying the premium. And we want to offer an added incentive for people to take out insurance as early as possible. If there is no incentive, then people will wait, drag their feet. We'll be consulting the public on this proposal. But then concerning those aged 40 or above, how do you define the high-risk group? So we don't have the say. You have all the say. Now we have many insurers in the market. Company A may think the risk is very high, but Company B may not agree. And also there are actuaries to do the professional calculations. But then in the first year, the government underwrites everything. In other words, if the insurer doesn't want to accept the risk, the government will accept the risk. Now, but then for people who are over 40 and with preconditions, it will be difficult for them to take out insurance. But then they pay threefold premium. And the extra will be borne by the $50 billion fund, right? And if the government, or if the government's $50 billion is used up, then maybe many people will fall within the definition of the high-risk group. I mean, those over 40. Now, because if you say that I am of the high-risk category, then I will not be able to take out any insurance. In the first year, the government underwrites everything, but now it seems that you are trying to cap the government's commitment. Now, in theory, the insurance company may still accept the subscriber, but then the premium may be very, very high, or there may be a lot of exclusions. So we want to know whether the consultants are proposing a cap to the government's commitment. I think you should allow people over 40 years old to join the scheme, and also you should allow people some more time to monitor the effectiveness of your scheme. Now, in fact, there are about 2 to 3 million people who are existing policyholders, and if your scheme is good, then you need not worry that they will not join your scheme. And if you think all these schemes can meet the minimum requirements, then you need not be worried. You can see that there are 2.8 million people who have proved to you that they take out insurance before they are ill. But then there is this problem of inertia. In fact, this problem was seen in many overseas countries. But then if there is an age limit, then people may choose to start taking out insurance when they are 20 or 30 years old. It's a balance, a matter of balance.
When you consult the public, please also consult the public on this point. KK Kwok, I think you raised your hand in the second round. Do you have a question? Chairman, sorry. Please do not limit my time because I think it's a little unfair. We only have 2 minutes, but Chairman, you spoke for a longer time. I don't think you should do that. I think you should also follow the rules. Sorrow, because I could see that there was nobody in the queue. Well, no. Some members spoke for more than 2 minutes, but you did not stop him. You are not using any rules. I don't know how the meeting can be conducted. Chairman, I'd like to ask a question with regard to what the PS said just now. I find it strange that you kept mentioning one point. You are saying that patients go to the public hospitals. You said 50% of them still go to public hospitals, and that is not an ideal situation. I don't know whether you know the situation on the ground. First of all, there are not enough beds in private hospitals. Secondly, there is no transparency in the fee charging scheme. And number three, they are free to hike fees whenever they like. You regulate them as charities, but there is no regulation at all. Later on, you say the Society for Rehabilitation, the Chinese University of Hong Kong and Hong Kong U will be able to do something, but things will just be the same. I think only Union Hospital is a non-profit making body, but you can't regulate the rest. You are saying that you want to move people away from the public system. I think that is unfair. You should do a proper job yourself. I am also against any form of subsidy. You said that if you are 50 years old and if they are in the HRP, they have to pay $15,000 a year. Chairman, how many people in Hong Kong can afford $15,000 a year? If they can, many of them don't need your subsidy. They will be able to fend for themselves. If you really want to help everybody, then you should not only select those who can afford $15,000 in premium to help them. And how can you be sure that by doing so, they will certainly leave the public system? Is it that you want to discriminate against them? So you want to force them away from the public system no matter what? If you say you would provide a subsidy and if the objective is to move them away from the private, the public system, first of all, this will not work. Secondly, if you do this, you are going to benefit the insurers, the private hospitals, and private doctors. This is not something you should do. If there is any form of subsidy, it should all be within the public system. And I also asked you a very simple question. If people use MRI and CT, if they have to pay such a high premium for it, well, look around the world. Nobody's doing that. The US insurance policy is quite rotten, but it is not asking people to co-share 30% of the cost. Very often, doctors have the authority to ask the patients to undertake necessary investigations. If even that is not possible, the patient will stand to lose. Even if there is a subsidy, they still have to pay a lot. And you are talking about subsidy using public money. Can you guarantee that the $50 billion will still remain in the public system and that you would provide better primary care? And in the end, the so-called subsidy will only encourage people to use the public hospital services more. But then we don't want people to be hospitalized. We want to provide better primary care so they do not have to go to hospitals to undertake such investigations and treatment. People who have a fever need not be hospitalized. How can you provide the insurance package so people are hospitalized? I think you are putting the cart before the horse. P.S. Maybe you can also attend to the next paper, and that is the public funding support for the implementation of the HPS. Chairman, let me answer the points made by Dr. K.K. Kwok. Number one, fee charging at private hospitals. We all understand fee charging is really about the balance between demand and supply. Right now, there is a deficiency of hospital beds in the private sector. We are doing a lot to increase the number of private hospital beds. In the next few years, there will be the addition of 1,000 beds in private hospitals. So we must try to balance demand and supply in order to tackle private hospital fees. But at the same time, we are doing a lot more. We do not only rely on the HPS to solve all the questions. We are reviewing the private hospitals ordinance, and we are really looking at fee transparency. We are talking to private hospitals to see how the fee charging standards can be more uniform so people can know what payment has to be paid upfront, and so they know whether they can afford it, and there would also be a complaint system. This is what we are doing about private hospital fees. I must also stress that we have no intention at all to move people away from the public system. We are not forcing people away from the public system. We have always been saying that many people have taken out private insurance, but at the same time, they're not using it. And they are not happy with it. And also, when they need to use a private hospital, they cannot make use of the insurance cover. That is why we see a need to step up our control of the private insurance market to increase its transparency so people have more confidence in taking up private insurance so that their benefits can be covered. This is the main purpose of the HPS. As for public funding, this is because in the last round of public consultation, the public have said that some people cannot take out insurance because they have high-risk health conditions. Now, so how can we allow these people also to take out insurance if they want to? I think the government has the responsibility to provide a workable solution in the coming round of public consultation and talk to the public how we can balance the needs and the benefits. Say, for example, we might like to follow overseas examples, for example, to force the insurers to accept everybody. But then we're aware of the long-term operation of insurers and also the premium to be charged for private health insurance. That is why we are not going to propose a compulsory system. And then, at the same time, we have to be accountable to the public who want to take out insurance but cannot. That is why we are making this proposal. And the proposal might entail the use of public funding to the tune of billions. We will be giving the details in due course, how this will be done and how much money is involved, say, over a period of 25 years, and also how much the premium will be. After consultation, we will see whether the public buy in that idea. If they don't, then it will just be like the present. If they have pre-existing conditions, if they are in poor health, then there is a possibility that they cannot take out health insurance. This is about the $50 billion. Mr. K.K. Kwok said that we should concentrate on strengthening services in the public sector. Indeed, we agree. We say there would be a dual-track effort. Dr. K.K. Kwok would understand that every year we provide funding to the hospital authority by increasing it 10% year on year. There are new hospitals being built as well. So we are not doing less in any way in providing public hospital services. As for the $50 billion, now, even if we have the HRP in future, well, we understand the concern of the public. We don't want to use too much money. That is why we're going to design an option so that it will only make use of a portion of the fund at most, and the rest of the money will be for enhancing the public system to meet long-term needs. Any follow-up? Mr. Chen Kinpo. Is it that we are talking about the $50 billion now? P.S., can you walk us through the other paper, the $50 billion? Public funding support, tax incentives, etc. That will be in addition to the $50 billion. Chairman, indeed, in the second paper, we have told members how we are considering making use of public funds to support the HPS. And we have been talking about the high-risk pool, because in the last round of public consultation, the main concern of the public about the insurance market is that it is very difficult for high-risk people to take out insurance. Usually, the insurers would refuse the application, and even if they are accepted, there will be additional conditions or that high premium is charged. That is why we are proposing that later on the insured should be accepted even if they have pre-existing conditions. And the additional loading should only be 200% of the premium. Now, this proposal will allow high-risk people to take out and afford health insurance. But then if the insurer cannot get enough premium to offset the risk, the extra premium will just be put on the shoulders of other subscribers, and that may reduce the appetite of the other subscribers. So we are thinking of a high-risk pool, and we are saying if the premium will be set at 200% or higher, then when the policy becomes effective, the policy can be transferred to the HRP, and the insurer will continue to take care of the administrative cost, but then the claims, profits, etc., all that would go into the HRP, but not the responsibility of the insurer. And if necessary, the administration will consider providing financial support to the HRP. The consultant will calculate the necessary financial support in the final report. As for the financial incentive in encouraging the public to take out health insurance, the consultant has proposed that the administration do this for people taking out the minimum requirement policy, and that is to provide a tax incentive. It should be simple and easy to understand, and this will be an incentive for people to maintain the policy for a long time. Compared to other financial options, for example, to provide direct subsidy, etc., there will be less administrative work. Now, to provide a discount or something, this may cause the insurers to jack up premium and pocket a significant portion of the premium subsidy or discount. In comparison, tax deduction would be based on net chargeable income, and insurers would have little knowledge or control over the same thing. And this will be less costly administratively because we already have an established system for providing the tax incentive. This is how we are designing the HRP, and also how we propose to use public funding to support the HPS.
Mr. Chen Kin Po. Now I want to say that the chairman is really being too kind. You didn't clarify to the member that you allowed me to speak for a few more minutes because there wasn't anyone in the queue. Oh, I think the administration does not tell you the truth concerning MRI. There is the factor of a moral hazard, and also the premium will go up very substantially, and it will be very difficult to market the product to the public. But I think you have to tell the public clearly that cost is a very important factor. Now, for ambulatory or day hospital service, and also MRI, it's important that there is a co-payment, or the premium will be very, very high. And then concerning this paper, I want to say that I'm very disappointed, and we want to encourage young people who are still healthy to start subscribing. Now, in overseas countries, the tax rates are high, and so tax concessions are a very attractive incentive. But in Hong Kong, many people don't need to pay tax, and some only pay 7.5% to 8%. So do you think a few hundred dollars of tax deduction is enough as an incentive? But then I understand that if there is continuous subscription, I know that in some countries there will be government subsidy after the age of 65. Now, we are not saying that we want the money to be placed with the insurance companies, because you know the investment environment is very difficult. Now, say there would be a regulatory agency, and so when the person is over 65 years old, or when he has subscribed continuously for 30 years, then you can start offering the concession or the discount, and people will have more confidence in the scheme. Thank you. Permanent Secretary. As Chairman, Mr. Chen is saying that a tax reduction is not attractive enough as an incentive. Now we want to encourage people to take out insurance at an early stage in life. There are many things we need to do, including guaranteed renewal and ensuring the quality of the products. So we have all these things added together to act as incentives. Then we need to look at cost effectiveness. And any discount offered will affect the operation of the market. Let's say, for example, how can we make sure that the discount will be reflected in the premium, and we have no intention at all to regulate premium levels. KK Kwok? I think it's problematic to have the government subsidizing the high-risk pool. I understand that for the tax deductions, the $50 billion will not be taken into account. So how are you going to spend the $50 billion? You will encourage people to take out insurance, you will subsidize the high-risk pool. So are there other ways to spend the $50 billion in a better way, in a wiser way, for example, enhancing or strengthening primary health care so that there will be less hospital admissions? I do agree that we need to reduce medical costs. For the hospital authority, we're talking about over $40 billion. This is not satisfactory. I think you should strengthen primary health care in order to reduce hospital admissions. It's reported in the news that patients have to wait for 15 hours, for example, I beg your pardon, before they can be admitted. But if their problems can't be solved at the primary healthcare level, they will have to seek secondary healthcare. I think the $50 billion is extremely attractive to the insurance companies. I don't think insurance companies will reject the $50 billion. And so I just want to know in what way the government can use this amount of money in a better way. Permanent Secretary. In the last consultation exercise, some members of the public said that they were not able to take out insurance because of pre-existing conditions. So we needed to find some ways to help this group of people, and we felt that public funding support would be required. But of course, at the same time, we need to continue to invest in the public healthcare system so that in the long run, the hospital authority will be better able to cope with the demand or the increase in service demand. And that will, of course, include primary healthcare. But then that will not be directly related to the regulation of HPS is another initiative under our bureau. We are mindful of the need to bring about improvements to the public healthcare sector. We need to try to bring up, improve people's health and try to reduce emissions. So how much money have you committed to subsidize the high-risk pool. So how much money are you insisting to spend? And we've made a commitment. We are talking about several billion dollars in the next 25 years, Chairman. But then it really depends on whether we're talking about twofold or threefold premium, and whether we should draw the line at 40 years old. And we'll make a decision after we've gauged public response. Mr. Kwok. I want to know the premium for subscribers at the age of 40, 45, or 50. For those who can afford $15,000 a year, they can fend for themselves. $15,000 a year, those who can afford this amount do not really need your subsidy. We should help those who are really in need of your subsidy. Permanent Secretary, the whole amount will be used in the high-risk pool? Yes, please be concise. The savings component, all those have been deleted. So the $50 billion will be used exclusively for the high-risk pool, is that correct? Then we need to calculate how much we need for the HRP, 5 billion, 6 billion, over how many years, 25 years. And then we'll have to look at how we can make use of the balance. And as Mr. Kwok has suggested, the balance can be used to improve upon the public sector system. So we'll just be spending the money on the high-risk pool, and will not be spending money on other aspects of the HPS. So it seems that you are trying to reduce your commitment even further. So you're going to spend some of the $50 billion on improving the public sector. We're talking about balance between the private sector and the public sector. We encourage people to take out insurance. At the same time, we also need to carry out healthcare reforms in the public sector. Mr. Chen, I want to ask the government whether it has political considerations. Many people said that the $50 billion should be invested into the public healthcare system. And now you're saying that $4.3 billion will be required for the high-risk pool in the first year. So it seems that you want to reserve the $40 billion for the public healthcare sector. Now I'm worried that you set up this scheme and there is no subsidy, and there will be a lot of complaints from the public. Now even if your commitment is reduced to $4 billion, the Democratic Party will not support you. Dr. Kwok won't support you. I won't support you either. I don't know who will support you. So it's really a waste of everybody's time. Why not use the time and resources on other more meaningful initiatives? Your consultant estimates that about $4.3 billion will be required. And I understand the parameters for his calculation. And the high-risk pool will be operated by the insurers. The insurers will issue the policies, but then you'll get someone to operate the pool. And you think 12.5% would be the cost. The insurance sectors of the view that 12.5% will not be enough, because you're talking about commission profit or miscellaneous expenses. In the US, is 15%. So why do you think 12.5% will be okay? And what if insurance companies are all unwilling to operate the high-risk pool? Will you be doing it yourself? Permanent Secretary. Now, for the high-risk pool, the front-line administration work will be carried out by the insurance companies. Considering the cost, I think it's not difficult to work out the cost based on the facts. And then about $4 billion, some are worried that you set up the high-risk pool, but what if the commitment far exceeds $4 billion? The people join the high-risk pool in the belief that they will not need to be worried. So I think you need to tell these people that your commitment is not limited, it's a lifelong commitment. Well, our estimate is a reasonable one, but of course no estimate can be 100% accurate. And if there is any error, of course we will have to bear the responsibility. In fact, when insurance companies launch certain products, they do their professional calculations. And so far, they haven't really erred too much in their calculations. But I think the Permanent Secretary has not answered my question, Chairman. Now, people join the high-risk pool because they are confident that there will be government subsidy. So, this is the legitimate expectations of the policyholders, and they believe that the government's commitment will go on even if the $4.3 billion has been depleted. Now, the commitment is ongoing. But then we need to have the duration and the amount. So we're talking about this approximate figure for a 25-year period. But it doesn't mean that the commitment will only be for 25 years. We just want to the public to know the cost implications. So in other words, the policyholders will not have to shoulder the blame if your calculations are wrong. But when insurers get their calculations wrong, they increase the premium.
So have you finished? I have certain things to ask them. Okay, you have a go. First, my question for the PS is minimum requirement. You say nothing about the policy coverage. Now you say people pay $3,600, but if they undergo a major operation, how much would that be? Let us say $50,000. And then if people can't afford it, at $3,600, they will offer a 10% discount, $3,300. And then for a major operation, the cost will go down to $45,000 instead of $50,000. They can do this, right? No. The paper itself is quite short and simple, but in fact, the maximum amount for every operation will be given, how much hospitalization will cost, etc. We will have a whole list of the fees. Under which item do you say there will be a certain premium that will be charged? We are not giving any figures here. No, actually, you have the annex, the proposed minimum requirements for standard plan. Where can we see the premium for a major operation? Proposed minimum requirements. Where? Which one? Number 8, over the page, page 14, that is, it is almost like a policy. Do you have a question? You just said that now MRI, CT scan are not included. But no, if you are hospitalized, these are covered. No, the thing is, they do different things now. We are not saying that definitely these are not covered, but some do, some don't. With regard to the latest medical technology, very often people have to undergo such procedures, and that is why we think these should be included in future. But now, some policies do not include them, and people have to pay for them themselves. Look, the reality is, these are included. Don't say they are not included. If people are hospitalized first, then these are included. People go to a hospital to be hospitalized, and in reality, these are included. Now, you ask people to pay 30% co-insurance, so people lose out. Well, no, you have to look at it as a whole. If they are not hospitalized, then it is less expensive, and so the premium will also go down as a result. No, the thing is, if they have a cancer operation, then they are hospitalized anyway, and these are diagnostic procedures, so they make use of the opportunity to do it. Say they have colon cancer, then of course they will also do the MRI while they are hospitalized. But now you ask people to pay the 30% coinsurance, so people stand to lose. But what about it is just an investigative procedure? Say people suspect that they have cancer, but then those who are already having a major illness, they would lose out. Now, Chairman, these are the details. If this is your view, then if this is required of an operation, then they may not have to pay the co-insurance. That is why we'll have another round of consultation, because we want to know your views. Next, I'd like to confirm something. The FS put aside $50 billion, and we understood it to be for the supplementary financial scheme instead of using it for any public health purposes. Is it that you have changed your policy? In other words, the $50 billion under the new Bureau Secretary will be spent also for primary care and to fund other medical policies. Is that right? Because our understanding is, if I could look up the budget where the $50 billion was put aside, in fact, the administration was thinking about a supplementary medical funding scheme. That was early in the days. There were the six options, maybe a mandatory scheme or personal savings account, etc. But it was said anyway that the $50 billion would be for the, or a seed money for a supplementary medical funding scheme. And now you say over $40 billion would be for the high-risk pool, but then, well, other members may agree with you, but I just want you to clarify whether you have changed your policy. Is it that $45 billion odd will be for other purposes outside what the FS said? Because he was actually talking about making use of the fund as a seed money for the supplementary health funding scheme. Well, at that time, the details were not known yet, and the $50 billion was just put aside for it to be used if necessary. But now, after consultation, we think we can promote the private health insurance policy, and we may not need so much money. So you think 40% will be enough? Yes. And the remaining fund would be for medical services reform. We need to support the development of the public market as well. Yes, I just like you to clarify matters. Many members might like that clarification as well. I think time is almost up. If we have more questions, we can ask them later. And perhaps during the public consultation period, the subcommittee may want to meet the various professions and also the public. I think a lot of changes have been brought in over the last 2 years. When are you going to start your public consultation? or when will you have all the details? We believe in the first half of next year, maybe March or April, but we cannot be sure because we have to undertake some internal procedures. March or April? We are still waiting for the final report from the consultant. You are still waiting for that report. If that's the case, if you will only conduct public consultation after the report is out, you will not know when you will do it. Mr. Chen Kingpo, what do you think? Are you saying that you'll be ready for public consultation only in March, April? Well, we will be releasing the public consultation paper. But can your report be finished at the end of the year? So before you conduct public consultation, you'll let us see the report first. So you want to read the consultant's report first before we have a public hearing. When will you give us the consultant's report? When will it be ready? Maybe by early next year, the latest, we'll have the final report. End of year or early January, is that right? We're waiting. Let us read the report first. If possible, the medical association, the insurers should be able to read the report first to see whether the proposals are workable or whether anything is wrong. I think you should allow the professions and the insurers to confirm the accuracy of the information first, because if you ask the public for their views based on wrong information, then you're not going to achieve a lot. If you can allow the insurance industry to read the report first, in other words, these people would actually be the business operators. You need them to agree or confirm the data before you conduct public consultation. Can you give us the report before the new year? And that is the Chinese New Year. And then by mid-February, after the Chinese New Year holidays, we can have a public hearing. Let me do that. I'll try my best. And the date of the next meeting will be in January. We haven't fixed a date yet. Let us have a meeting in January. We are going to talk about the regulatory framework and also the claims resolution scheme. We have talked about that already. Do you have new proposals or more concrete proposals? Well, I don't think so. We have nothing new, but we are going to include more details. You do not have anything new? I'll ask the clerk to follow up with you, because it seems everything is quite remote. You have to wait for the consultant's report? Yes. Okay, any more questions, members? Chairman, he said that he will give a written reply to the Insurers Federation. I hope he will clarify those points. Okay, we will do that. We will reply to the Federation in writing. Sorry. Okay, so the meeting is adjourned. Thank you very much.